A big warm welcome. It is the first day of spring, and thanks for joining us for the Wednesday Lunchtime Super Series. Resilience in business and life in a changing world is our theme for the next five sessions. Thanks for joining us. It is recorded, and you'll be able to watch it if you miss the live sessions today. So a really big thank you, and on behalf of the Business Benchmark Group, Cognercise Foundation, the Phillips Brothers Foundation, we bring to you hopefully a really enriching program in business for you in the next few sessions. Just recapping also on the word resilience, I think that we're all finding that at the moment. We're going to need our best, and the definition of it being the capacity to recover quickly from difficulties. I just looked up, I Googled it like we'd all Google things, and then toughness is written after. And I think it does require a huge amount of toughness and resolve, deep human resolve to get through, whether you've gone out of business, lost your job, lost your income. You know, we're back in that survival mode. And although spring's opening up, and what a beautiful day today, that should invigorate us to get on and still be human and go for what we can and seek the next opportunity that comes. We've got a great program lined up, as I said, and just following on from last year where we had some great sessions on the why you get into business, your belief systems, what are your deep values of why you do business and do your role and your job. We talked about building capacity in your business and scaling things up, being impact makers, getting stuff done, really getting the job on the road there. We talked about adaptability, which is in these days is probably the absolute key word. We all know no greater certainty in life that things will change, and they're certainly changing rapidly. So that's it. And the power of now, we can only do what we're doing right now. And so that was the series last September. We can't believe 12 months has gone around, but we thought it'd be great to just get together again and put forward some more fun and interesting things we're learning in a year on. And we'll go through that with our speakers today. Our anchor, Stefan Kazakis, as we said, from the Business Benchmark Group. It's great to have a leading business coach and developer of businesses. Stefan's going to talk today about the importance of goal setting mastery and the power of rewords, in resilience, as we just said at the start. We've got Andrew Phillips, as we know, yes, founder, director of Camp Australia, now of Grow Corp and the Phillips Brothers Foundation. And he'll talk about building resilience based on adversity. Tougher times are actually the things that strengthen us. Don't give up. Work through adversity to shine at the end. And Judd Murray, our resident well-being, health and fitness expert, to help us with our corporate business fitness. Each of us are founders of our own business and CEO of our own organic businesses. Resilience requires courage, strength, skill, and plasticity, and reflects honestly the levels of confidence we have in ourselves. So on that note, we're going to roll into our anchor today, Stefan Kazakis. Welcome.
Thanks, Anthony. And it's amazing what happens in 365 days. It's been that long since we were here collectively giving back and doing whatever we could a year ago to help those that, by virtue of a lunchtime sharing every Wednesday last September in 2020, how can we help someone move a little further? So I start my conversation with, and please, everybody, feel free to get engaged in the chat, ask any questions, make any as you relate to observations. And I'll start with this as it relates to where we are in 2021, and perhaps for some of us feeling not much has changed. If I was to ask you to consider any rewords, any words that start with an R and E, such as relationships, such as re-engagement, such as reactivation, such as results. And there's a starting point. In the next 60 seconds, while I get ready to share my sharing here this afternoon, what I'd love everyone to do right now, go to the chat, get engaged in the chat, and put as many rewords that are meaningful for you. In other words, relationships, referrals, results, recommendations, repeat, reinvigoration, whatever your rewords are, put them in the chat right now. Let's see how far we can go as it relates to rewords in this room. Now, my journey in business started in the early 90s. I took over a family business, and more importantly, I took over a family business that I had no desire, no plan. It was not my plan certainly did not go to university to start and get involved in the family business. That was an amazing business that hit a brick wall and almost went broke in the late 80s and early 90s. Mum and dad went from very, very rich to almost losing the family home. I took over that business, and every day I turned up to that business for almost 10 years, where I hated being there in every moment of my time. And what I got to understand in that journey was there was a line for which my mentors, my coaches helped me understand, and they referred to this line as my glass ceiling. And what they said to me, Stefan, there are the things that you can control, and then there are things that you cannot control. And as it relates to the things we can control and the things we can't control, there is this line. And typically that line represents, what are you doing with your time? What is it that you could be doing with your time as it relates to relationships, as it relates to reactivation, as it relates to re-energize, as it relates to get going and move your opportunity and your problem forward? And in the time that we're in right now, as it relates to 2021, and it feels like for many of us, I know for me and my community, it feels like a bit of Groundhog Day. However, what are the things I can control as it relates to new opportunities? See, many of us in the world that we live in right now have a thing called a phone. We have Zoom. We have opportunities of communication that were never, ever, ever possible for us 10, 15, 30, 50 years ago. And therefore, the opportunity to reactivate, re-energize, re-engage, and ultimately get moving forward, go reach out and make relationships. They're the things you can control. What is it that you're doing at a personal level? Where is the personal level as it relates to who do I go to and who do I complain to? Who do I let go of as it relates to the things that are holding me back? And what is it that's holding me back and I shouldn't be allowing that to hold me back? And how do I move forward? These are the things I can control. Finance, money, numbers. How is it that I use finance as something that I use and leverage and ultimately help me move forward? So building resilience when times gets tough, building momentum when time gets tough, is also a byproduct of your identity around money and numbers, your team, your workflow, your other people that are, whether they're relationships or whether they're on your team right now, whether it's your family and loved ones. How is your personal team, your business and professional team helping you help the work flow? And the most important bit, because if you don't get that one right, the thing that you control the most is, what are you putting as it relates to positivity, as possibility and progressive opportunity in terms of your headspace? Your personal development has got nothing more and nothing else to do with anyone else. It's got to do with you at an individual level and what you're putting your attention to. So in life, particularly challenging times, the most important thing that you can do, and as I got to learn this in 1993 with Basil Port, my most amazing coach of the time, I needed to really get true to what can I control and be aware of and not be so consumed by what I can't control. In fairness, our life, as we look at it, is a journey. And in 500 weeks' time, in 250 weeks' time, certainly a period that's longer than the next day ahead, there is so much possibility. And as human beings, we don't spend as much time in thinking about that. So let's have a look at how many rewords were put in the chat. Let me have a look at it. Repeat, reschedule, reason, resilient, reachable, rebuild, responsible, re-strengthening, revolution, reasonable. Every one of those words except for reason is a positive word. Wow, resonate, strong word. Thank you, Kim. What else have we got? Refine, reboot. Look at this. These are all positive, progressive, opportunity-based words. Keep on focusing on your rewords, because it's the rewords, it's your rewords that are going to help you move and get out of the rut, if there is such thing as a rut. A rut is something I can't control. Progression and movement is something I can, and that's what we need to be doing. Excellent work. Let's keep on moving. Oops. There are five phases as it relates to your small business. If you're running a small business and you're in this room, and many of you are, then there are five phases. We always start as being the best best employee in our business. We are the best technician in our business. And before we know, we've got a few more customers, a few more vans, a few more clients to look after, a few more people to look after, and we need to manage them. All in all, I started that business day one thinking I was the owner, but I'm utilizing less than 5% of my working hours in being a business owner, which means you're getting in the way of being the best investor eventually. So over the next 4 to 5 weeks, I'm going to keep on unpacking the 5 phases of SME business and how much courage it takes and how much opportunity you have for the life and the business that you dreamed of building. And what I get to see around the world is rarely a bad business, but I do meet business owners who do get in the way. So how can I help you? How can we help you through these next 5 weeks during the September Super Series of resilience in our life and in our business, and how we can conquer it and use it as an advantage as we move through the ownership journey of being a self-employed or a manager or an owner and moving to investor mindset. The business conveyor belt, as we share it here, it's our methodology here at Business Benchmark Group. Who is it that I need to attract? I get to attract them. How easy do I make it for them to buy? How do I ensure that I'm handing over to operations so it's delivered on time and on budget and a little bit more than what was promised? If I do that consistently, I'm going to get repeat and referral and ultimately a waiting list of A-grade clients wanting to buy from me and or my business. And if I do that successfully and I'm invoicing every other day and getting paid every other day, then cash flow is what turns up. Lead flow, workflow, cash flow. Repeat, repeat, repeat. Rubber hits the road, execution on strategy with people that are better than you ultimately delivers cash. Profit is the outcome of every one of our businesses in this room. Profit is the number one driver for why we go into business to begin with, no matter what you do with your profit, because then that goes to what is your personal and what is your business goals. And here's where I'm going to take you next. When it comes to mastery, and the most important part about mastery, and it's number one, goal setting mastery is the most important thing we do in our life. Goal setting mastery is one of the most important things that we do in our business. And it comes in that sequence. What do you want? What do you truly want? What do you envision? What do you idolize as it relates to your ideal life? And if you get really clear at that, if you get really clear on what's the ideal, then you're going to be okay to talk about it. You're going to be okay to verbalize it. And if you can verbalize something that you could visualize, then your opportunity to actualize is to your advantage. Hence why goal setting, particularly in times such as these, where you have an opportunity to be really clear about what do you want, and you need to be selfish, because your opportunity to build something that is 250, 500, 1,500 weeks away from today is your opportunity to get going and get motivated for the things you can control. And yes, COVID will come, and 100%, just like every other points of drama in our history of human beings, will go. It will definitely be a blink. It will definitely be one of those spike zones. It'll be a reference point, but it can't define you. You need to get stronger and better and more progressed. And it's goal setting mastery that helps you focus on the long term, for which as human beings, we so underestimate what can happen in the long term and so overestimate and get disappointed and really stressed out about what's not happening in the short term. So goal setting mastery is about what is the health that you are optimizing for? What does your health levels need to look like? How are you truly investing and looking after yourself as it relates to the health goals? What is it as it relates to your relationships? Many of us have got that work-life harmony, work-life balance a little out of whack. Your time management is a little whack. You're so committed to just being busy. However, are you being productive? So your goals around your relationships with your loved ones, with your family, with your stakeholders, with your interests, how is it that you're building momentum and not ever jeopardizing the relationships that are sacred? You are putting time and energy and as much time and energy into your relationships as you are in being a better person. Business, what are your business goals? What does this thing look like when it's finished? What does it look like when you exit? Are you exiting to a management team? Are you exiting to a 7, 8, 9, 10 multiple to investors who are lining up to buy something that is predictable for profit? Your wealth goals, my God, so many of us missed this one. So having a health goal and having a wealth goal has got nothing to do with other than what do you truly want? What do you truly need? So having a wealth goal, which I'm going to share a little bit more on this, your charitable goals, your philanthropic giving back goals, charity. You know, this is the third phase of goal setting. The third phase of goal setting is giving back. In order to give back at volumes, in order to give back that truly nourishes your spirit, you need to be in a position where you have driven through walking away goals, moving towards goals, giving back goals. That's the third phase of goals. And toys and materialistic stuff, experiences, they're also goals. And I'm not here to judge whether you are into your materialistic and or experience type goals versus your philanthropic. I'm just here to say, here are your goal setting categories that each of us need to. And it's important to be really selfish and go for it. So the better I can see the ideal, the truer I get to visualize that, the better I start talking about it, and ultimately, look what shows up. Here's a very important slide, and this sort of dovetails into our guest speaker next week, Tim Donoghue, who's an expert at creating wealth and helping every one of us grow wealth. In saying that, in Australia, we have a life expectancy of 4,264 weeks. If you are right now in this room and you're in your 50s, you're in your 40s, you're in your 30s, you're in your 60s, you're in your 70s, have a look at this from a macro perspective. If you're in your 40s and you only are prepared to live to the average, you have 2,000 odd weeks available. If you're in your 70s, you have 624 weeks available. Now, depending where you are, it's never too late. What I get to see and understand, I have the privilege through my own journey in life, because that business that was broken, we ended up selling it for millions in 2002. What I've got to see and experience in life is it's never too old to decide this is what I want. So if you were to work to the average level of life expectancy, and on this chart here, just figure out where are you right now. In the chat, write down for me, how many weeks do you have based on this chat? I'm hoping every one of you has a health goal that takes you to 100 years. 100 years, which is almost a lot many more weeks than the average, right? So in the chat, tell me where you are. If you were to retire, so wealth goals, looking at things from a longer period than you ever have before. If you were to retire at the age of 60 and you were to live to the average in Australia of 82, you would need at an average level between you and a loved one, $100,000 a year. $100,000 a year, and you need accessible $2.2 million to enjoy and so have the life that you deserve at an average level. If you were to play that game at an above level, at an above average level, to do things at the higher level, why wouldn't you? Because of all the work you've put in up until this point. Now, many of you will retire at 70, others will retire at 50. It makes no difference. What are your numbers? What are your numbers as to your goals that you are setting as it relates to the life that you truly have dreamed of and deserve? And your business is the driver. Your career right now is your driver to afford you the life that you deserve. So goal setting mastery, particularly in times of toughness, particularly in times of challenge, your goal setting mastery is your key to the door that helps you bypass those that are getting stuck at another Dan Andrews PR exercise in the morning, right? You have the ability to look a lot further than you ever had, and COVID does stop many of us. Let's not kid ourselves. But your job is to look a lot further than that and know that the day will come when you get back on your horse and you are moving the things that you control forward. Any questions, any comments in the sharing? So, Anthony, from my perspective, I just want to share back to you. So that's my presentation for today, goal setting mastery. Actually, Rob, can you just put in the chat, can you put the poll of goal setting mastery in the chat right now? So can everyone just have a go at how do you rate yourself on goal setting mastery? Is it short term? Is it long term? If you know, 5 is excellent, 1 is very poor. Do you have a vision board? Do you have a bucket list? Do you have a commitment to looking at that, discussing it, sharing it, putting yourself out there and saying, this is what I want? Because these are the immediate things that you can control to get you focusing on progression. Anthony, from your perspective, just very quickly, while we're watching this poll be uncovered, from your perspective, how important is goal setting?
Oh, it's number one. I've always said to my kids and colleagues and a lot of elite sort of sports people I mentor now, goal setting's it. It's the roadmap. It's your plan. You keep it short and simple, usually one pages and 1 year at a time or month by month. And, you know, it's your scoreboard. You know, you're called the business benchmark group. It's a benchmark. Like, it's something you're going for. It's what inspires and stimulates you to go for something, to create action. And if you don't create action, you know, you fall short of goals and you feel, I suppose, unfulfilled if you don't get there. So, yeah, I think it's just, you know, it's so important. And they're, you know, smart goals. You know, they've got to be sustainable, measurable, you know, achievable, and they've got to be targeted to what you want. Like, it's really important you get the right type of goals. Yeah, it could be monetary, could be business, could be sporting career. Yeah, it could be just lifestyle, could be family-related stuff. It could be anything. So I think it's number one.
Yeah, brilliant. So if we look at this score, the score here on the poll, so we've had the majority of us in this room have average goal setting mastery. The only question I'll leave everyone with is, what do you need to do as an individual to be plus one on the score that you've just put in? And I think everyone that's just had a go at this can certainly move one step further. What do you need to do immediately in the next 48 hours, in the next 72 hours that helps each of you raise your standard for goal setting and ultimately be a plus one on the score you just owned? I'm good, Anthony. Thank you.
Fantastic, Stefan. Thanks so much. Great energy and got us off to a great start. And we're going to now throw to Andrew Phillips.
G'day, audience. Thanks so much, Ant, for the introduction earlier. And to Stefan, I've already got some texts from a few colleagues saying what a huge energy you have. And I think that's what we sort of all need at the moment. Interestingly, you know, Anthony and I were in business together for 30 years and probably followed our passion for kids and sport. And interestingly, in my post-sale sort of new work at GrowCorp, one of the colleagues on the call today, we're going through a process at the moment of the good life. What is the good life? And the second part of that is, what would be your perfect job? And it was been really interesting because I started reflecting on the fact that sometimes that, well, I'm 51 now, I'm not sure the average age of the audience, but, you know, do we really know what the good life is or the perfect job, or do we just follow either siblings or parents or into business, or, you know, whether an employee or a business owner? And it's an interesting phase of my life to actually reflect back and go, what would it be to be in the perfect job? The amount of time, the energy, the passion and the purpose. So in addition to your challenge there, Stefan, on what people were thinking about their mastery of goal setting, some deep reflection too for business owners and employees. What would be the good life for you? And what would be your perfect job? I'll give you that little bit of homework for next week. And I'm actually currently going through mine, and some deeper thinking has challenged a lot of those thoughts. So, again, thanks so much for all of the people that attended last year. We just had a wonderful a month. And for the new colleagues that have just joined us, you know, hopefully we'll be out of this lockdown soon. But, yeah, talk about resilience. We're building that and staying connected. Thanks to Ant to bring this together this year, because staying connected is so very important. I think the work that Judd and Stefan do and myself, hopefully from my perspective, I'm going to bring some storytelling to our business that can give people some hope that I think we're all in the same bucket. You know, none of us are immune to harder times and having to build resilience. And some of the stories that I'll share today, I'm sure you've either gone through or will go through, as we did in our 30 years. So I'm just going to share my screen. And talk a little bit to those points. And again, these are, sorry, I'm just going to get rid of the, minimize my people. So just a quick summary. Last year, we went through the business stages. There were the 4 or 5 weeks we did. We looked at what it was like for a person to be in a startup business, the rapid growth that comes after startup, the significant value add, and then, of course, towards exit. And over the next few weeks, I'm going to talk a little bit about why we exited and then life after exit. I think it's quite relevant. I've had about four or five colleagues in the last month speak to me about their stages of life. Maybe it's COVID, maybe it's related to where the challenges their business are at, but they're starting to think about exit. So I look forward to reviewing that session with you next week for those who might have missed it last year. And also, everybody can go back to the Phillips Brothers website for last year's recordings, and I'm sure through Stefan's business that all those are there if you want to recap on last year. I remember sitting in my office and I put up this one little post-it note, and I reckon I had it there for about 15 years, and it was that two words, be positive. Now, it's bloody difficult at times, I know it is, but for me, and I had some personal challenges with some physical injuries, we had massive challenges within our business, but I just remember looking at that little yellow post-it note. And when I left the business 30 years later, I did take that little yellow post-it. It was stuck pretty hard to that wall it was on. But if I could just encourage everyone to have that one thing about keeping a smile on the dial, being positive, even in the darkest times. And two of the other little cartoon characters we did share last year, which I love, are these two. This is my peanuts. This is my depressed stance. When you're depressed, it makes a lot of difference how you stand. The worst thing you can do is straighten up and hold your head high, because then you're going to start to feel better. So if you're going to get any joy out of being depressed, you've got to stand like this. And I love that cartoon character when I saw it. And again, challenges that sometimes keep our head down, and you can see anything with the positive attitude. And that last one on the right-hand side with the frog going down the pelican's neck, never giving up. And I think it is testament to probably, Anthony, our journey over 30 years that we never did give up. I'm just going to try and get rid of some of these. There we go. So as I mentioned earlier, building resilience for me, when Anthony asked me to consider it, I thought, well, these are just, you know, some experiences from our 30-year journey. And one thing a mate said to me the day after our sale, and he said, well, yeah, well, it takes 30 years to build an overnight success. And it really rang true to me that, you know, you have these building blocks, and Stefan went through that in his presentation, from day to day, week to week, year to year, month to month, year to year. And for us, you know, a couple of things I've said in here, no one's immune to any of these personal or business challenges. I remember reading, some of you may have read this book, Life is Difficult. The sooner you realise it, the easier it becomes. The Road Less Travelled, M. Scott Peck. I would encourage anybody to go and get that book. It's a wonderful life book. Second point there, I thought, interesting, most of the growth comes at a time of adversity. Not that you know it up front, but I remember David Parkin saying, one of my coaches at Carlton, winners shine in the face of adversity. And I certainly do believe through these hard times, we get stronger and build that resilience. And then one of the things that was really interesting post-sales, retrospectively, we can feel the positive effects and actually remember more vividly and somewhat affectionately the hard times, even more so than the good times. The only way is up. Jeff Phillips, the chairman of Camp Australia, would always remind us that even in the toughest times, we used to be at the the top of the straight at Flemington in the Melbourne Cup. So you're nearly at the finishing line. And the only way is up was always a motto that rung true in our business about where we're at. Building resilience too, I thought of three or four challenges we had. And I know it's a common thing in Australia, tall poppy syndrome, but Anthony started our business on a little old bitumen tennis court at Geelong Grammar School. And he started coaching a few kids because the old retired coach there, he was pretty old and fuddy, and he wasn't really advancing the kids much. So Anthony actually took it upon himself to build a little tennis coaching business. And would you believe that to try to deter that, the rest of the teachers in that whole school created a teachers union to try and ban Anthony from starting this small business on the side. That was in the first year, and we took it to 30 years, and we still worked with that same school 30 years later. Talk about building resilience over a tall poppy syndrome. The second one, I do vividly remember that our business nearly never got started. We had some school counsellors in some schools that said, no, you can't do this. We're in childcare within schools. So I actually went into the legal department in the Department of Education in Victoria and overhauled the legal contract to allow us to be able to work with school councils and schools, and the rest is history, building from one school to 800. And then would you believe, within the last 2 weeks of a 30-year journey of trying to sell our business, we'd never had any negative feedback at all, ever. And then the Australian Financial Review, through a private equity leak and a New South Wales government trying to railroad us, a very opportunistic chance to devalue the sale of our business. So again, this may or may not happen in your business, but with competitors, anyone that wants to knock you, the tall poppy syndrome will be alive and well, but stay resilient. Cash flow, we had some issues in our business in regards to cash flow. And you know, it wasn't down at the bottom point there. There's no profit for 23 years. Talk about building resilience. Our last 7 years, we really few. But I was in that little picture there is the San Gimignano over in Italy. I was on my honeymoon. It was about midnight and I rang my brother to see how business was going. And he said, oh, we're in real strife. So I'll never forget, my wife reorganized all our flights straight out of Italy back to home halfway through our honeymoon. So talk about building resilience based on trying to save a business. So we'll do whatever we can. Another point I do dearly remember is that when we were trying to build our administration within our business, we built up significant debtors where parents basically wouldn't pay us. We had to rip the band off and actually write off $500,000 worth of debt, which in today's money might be in the millions, but for us, it was a fresh start, but it certainly built resilience in us to know that we have to get our systems and our scale right. There was a point halfway through our business, we didn't take on debt. We're an organic growth business, but we had to remortgage our homes and talk about the difficulties in doing that and the fear and being scared about the fact that where would you be if this business failed? So again, another chance to build resilience. And one very classic story I'll never forget, we didn't have bank support. We were banking with the Commonwealth Bank of Australia. We were growing so significantly that our payroll was in the millions. And we had to wait for government money to drop in from the childcare benefit support. We only had hours to go and we did not have working capital until Anthony was able to secure an overdraft for two hours before payroll. In the end, it was about 20 odd years into our business. We never used that overdraft, but basically the business would have fallen over had we not have gotten that reprieve right at the last hour. So again, building resilience on cash flow. And the last one for me, in regards to people, we're in a people's business. And I think my dad said 1 year, business would be great without people. Probably finding that now all sitting at home, we want to get back into the office so we can be with people and connected. But I think, you know, building and maintaining unwavering values and culture, being uncompromising, allowing no drift, being true to the wants, there will be people that will want to try to move away from that or have different values. Some of them have to move on, and that's very difficult. During our journey, we had two staff members pass away. I remember that being a very significant impact on our business and building resilience and connection with all the team, one through medical and one through a tragic accident. Very tough times for us. We also had a very dark day where we had to let 30 people go. I remember sitting in the boardroom one by one by one, having to let people leave the business, knowing that their livelihoods were going to be affected by it. Another deep learning we had was we went through five CEOs and five CFOs till we got it right, but we knew what we needed, so we never gave up. The disruption of the business to try to find the right answers for the right people was significant. And when we got that, it lifted like magic, but we knew, and this is what I talk about in the face of adversity. I remember looking back at the end of selling our business, that actually that toughest challenge of finding the right person and not settling for anyone's second best to get the best CFO and the best CEO to take over the seats that we weren't skilled in was part of the growth and the resilience. The senior leader team took 3 years to assemble. We had 11 people in our team, three in the family and eight in the business. And, you know, I talk about this saying, getting the bus pointing in the right direction. Get the right people with the right values, culture, and skill. Get people in the right seats on that bus. And then get that bus driving forwards always. Now, we had an infamous day where all of the relationships with our senior leader team were breaking up and infighting. We had one person storm out, fewer in tears. But we didn't give up on getting the right culture, the right values, and the skills. And when we got that lift at the 23-year mark of our business, everything changed. And lastly, the Rockefeller habits, which we talked about last year, a 10-year commitment to the rapid growth and sustainability using data, alignment, and rhythm. It took huge resilience to maintain that daily, weekly rhythm in our business with our people. So a few little stories. I wanted to just recap from last year, startup, rapid growth, value add. And next week and the weeks after, we'll be looking back to exit. And those who are thinking about exit, there's some wonderful stories. And what one of the questions that always has come up for people that I talk to is why? Why did you exit and when? When's the right time? So I'll be sharing some of those ideas. And of course, as Stefan mentioned, some of the new work that we're doing post 30 years in business. And I think one of the most important things about that is being able to think more deeply about life beyond just that one focused business that we had. So thank you. And back to you, Anthony. I really appreciate the opportunity to be back with everyone in the next 4 or 5 weeks.
Thanks a lot, Andrew. Great, and brings back a few memories, a few tears, a few joys, but that's part of resilience. I think it's the up and down, the roller coaster of our business journey in particular. And I think you and Stefan had both touched on that today. But the way, the antidote and the cures to resilience is with our expert, Judd Murray, wellbeing expert, and we're going to hand straight over to Judd.
Yes, g'day all. It's a privilege. It's an honour to be back speaking with you all again, and I love working with these guys. Their depth of experience and combined knowledge is huge, and it's humbling to be part of the group. But what I want to talk to you guys about is resilience in a practical individual level and business level. So I run a mind-body business. So I work with individuals and groups and have for the last 30-odd years, trying to help empower them to become the best, most confident version of themselves. And I see really sad stories. I'm part of really exciting opportunities. And I get all different aspects of the human psyche and the human self. Some people have overwhelming challenges in front of them, and others seem to be floating on a cloud and everything seems to work well. The job for me is to try and work out how to tease out some of the realities to create the best pathways, the best opportunities for people to live a positive, influential, and contented life. And sometimes that's difficult. Resilience really, as Ant said at the start, resilience is the ability to able to withstand challenges and to be able to bounce back, which is perhaps not coincidentally the same as fitness itself, measured by your ability to do work and to bounce back after completing work. So the idea is that we try and create that plasticity, that ability to build confidence and strength and to be able to reinvent ourselves when we're oppressed or when we're pushed down. And resilience probably is a big part of my business because I work really on one thing, and that's performance. And resilience really is performance over time, the ability to keep performing no matter what we face. Now, Stefan said some great things, as he always does, and I made some notes. And in the end, it sort of hijacked a lot of what I wanted to say because it was so inspiring. And some of the things he talked about is things that you can control and things that you can't control. Well, that pretty much summarizes a lot of what I do, trying to work out how to show people that control is where we start. Start off with the little things like posture, little things like breath, little things like diet, little things like social interaction. Avoiding avoidance, trying to engage. As Andrew said, connections are huge because your strong connections that you build and forge help give us faith, faith in ourselves and our network, which in the end helps gives us the confidence to be resilient. Confidence and resilience, they're partners. They work together. At the end of the day, if I believe in myself, which I work very hard to do, based on my experiences of success and resilience in the face of challenge, then I have the faith to try and try and try again. And this is really what it all comes down to. One of the things I often talk about regarding business is that each of us is our own business. I am the business of Judd, the CEO and founder of myself. My choices, my decisions, my successes and failures create the boundaries, the framework of my business. Now, talking again, Steph was talking about goal setting power. The goal, the driver, the narrative and story of my business helps me make my choices, helps me create. Resilience really comes down to, as they're insinuating, to the power of that goal in the face of knockers, of adversity, of negatives, the setbacks. And right now, all of us, but I'm being faced with trying to untangle the stresses that are coming from a situation that we can't control. And it's really, really difficult. So instead of trying to have all the answers to the issues of COVID, I again bring it all back to basics. Whether I'm stuck at home or whether I'm out in the public, it comes down to controlling myself, controlling what I do, how I react, the little things, those little one percenters all adding up to giving me the confidence, the capacity to function positively, as Andrew was talking about. Stay positive. Now, I've got 7 children, and when they were young and I was younger, my goals for my children were to be brilliant, were to be the best, so to speak. Now I've changed that. Luckily, I've matured. Luckily, I've become a little bit nicer, really. It's really about being kind to yourself and kind to others. The confidence, the resilience to be kind, even in the face of negativity. Grabbing that little sticker note that Andrew did, I think, was a good thing, because it's really important to remember you have control over your emotions. Remembering emotions are symptomatic. So if you don't want to feel negative, do positive things. It's funny, a lot of my clients, when they're feeling negative, they end up surrounding themselves in this gloom. They avoid, they cut off, they break connections. They stop chasing goals. They start to concentrate on comfort, short-term comforts, and avoidance. And the whole thing spirals down. Resilience can't function in that state. Resilience has to be tested. Building resilience has to be the product of trial and error, building through experience faith in yourself and in your capacity. Therefore, you have to, by definition, be pushing forward all the time. You can't hide and be resilient. You have to be courageous. So one of the things I often talk about, that you need strength, you need courage, you need skill, and as I said before, plasticity. And as Anne said at the start of this whole thing too, plasticity is a big thing at the moment. Adaptability, as Steph said. My business has taken a long time to mature. I've worked very hard over a long period of time, and not often with very obvious rewards. Retrospectively, I can see that there were rewards, but they weren't necessarily lining up with the goals I had at the time. But now when I look back, every struggle, every failure, every frustration was part of the framework that built the resilience that has become integral to my personal business. So now if I'm asked to speak to 5,000 people or 5 people, it doesn't matter, because it's the content that excites me. I'm just a vessel. My resilience comes from that knowledge. It's no longer about my ego. It's no longer about having to be the best. It's now the excitement of sharing, of teaching, of facilitating, of influencing. Which is why I love working with these guys, because they've got that same mentality. Yeah? Build, 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 and then give back. Which in the end creates this loop, this feedback loop, which makes us feel resilient. Because it's no longer about our fleshy self, about our aesthetic looks. It's about our content. And when you really start to believe in your own content, when you really start to believe in your own capacity and have faith in you and your contents and your contacts, your connections, resilience becomes easier. So when we're talking in the background here, I can see there's questions coming up. I can see there's comments coming up. I really want you to add your own story to this. Ask me questions because I'm here for you. Although I've only got 10 minutes or 12 minutes each session, I really want to work to help you guys create that sort of confidence in your situation, to build that narrative, to build that story so you can more courageously work into the future. Whether you've got 1,000 employees or one, whether or not it's just yourself, your ability to be resilient, to rebound after stress in the face of adversity, to skillfully actually do your best at all times, that is really the measure of the success of your business. And the profits that Steph talked about, the profits is in your own self-worth, in the value, in the legacy that you create. So ask me as many questions as you want about your own personal situation, and I'll try and come up with some solutions either during the sessions or outside the sessions. But lastly, through this next couple of weeks, these next couple of sessions, I'm literally going to give you some skills. I'm going to break down how and why we fall into some mental traps that we do. I've seen thousands of people, as I said, repeating the same mistakes. And I'm really looking forward to sharing with you some very good solutions to how to avoid that and to remain positive, proactive, and successful. Okay, back to you, buddy.
Thanks, Judd. Fantastic. And always enlightening. And it's if you get that self-care right and those personal qualities right, you need that as a base really to produce and be productive. So I think always really wise words. We've got a number of questions coming through. So we're just going to open up to the panel today. So we're going to throw perhaps to Andrew on this one. Just a little bit on the Rockefeller habits. I know we ran our business very stringently on these, especially in those profitable years, those last six or seven, as you said, Andrew. But maybe just a quick summary. We know what the key pillars of that are, and I know they're on our previous recordings, but Andrew might just quickly touch on those.
Yeah, thanks, Anthony. Thanks for the question from the panel. And I'll also touch on exhaustion, which I thought was the second question there. The Rockefeller Habits was a one-day seminar I went to, and we instituted it based on it being a long-term, what is quite an unfathomable, unrealistic goal, whether it be financial or otherwise. It sort of seems unrealistic at the time to sit at 0 years and put 10 years out and then breaking it back down to 90 days. So what are we going to do in the next 90 days? Put that 10-year plan in the drawer, wherever it is. So it's not about building sort of every year. I've obviously got to do strategies on the year, but it's about a 10-year vision and breaking it down to those 90-day sprints. Within those 90 days, the business has got to have the discipline to find out what are the top five problems in the business and then what's the top number one of those five and be laser-like focused in achieving that in all of the teams, focusing on the actual problems of the business. And through those 90 days, meeting with regular weekly meetings, so data alignment and rhythm. So making sure you've got a scoreboard. There's no use going anywhere without a scoreboard. It's like playing on the MCG without a scoreboard. You need the data in the business to give you the measurement. The alignment with the team is critical. So making sure that everybody knows where the company is headed and what focus is on for that week. And then the rhythm. And we talk about that weekly rhythm, making sure that all of the data is presented each week to the team. And that is basically what we did over, we sold 8.5 years into 10 of that, and we continually did that. And as of course, building that up to give the team an update every 90 days exactly where the business had moved forward. So there's a lot more, as you said, Ant, on the recordings from previous last year, so you can go through that in your own time. And I will briefly just touch, I saw the other question, it might have been from Manita on exhaustion. And I don't think there's anybody in this call that might not, in this series, that might not have either been there or faced it. When it happened to me, I had a nervous breakdown. So what I think is the most important thing, which I'm so grateful for, because it made me rethink my life and gave me an opportunity to think more about what I was doing. So I would encourage everybody out there that, you know, as my old man said, hard work never killed anybody. But exhaustion and not being in a position mentally, and Judd will talk more about this, of looking after your own well-being. If I could go back and look at what the toll it took on our business both Anthony and me, actually, in during those years, I would actually say, look at the holistic self. What are you doing as a person? What are you doing with your husband, wife? What are you doing with your family? What are you doing with your friends, your community, and then the wider world, and break it into those things and make sure you're giving yourself the time. So that's a very brief thing on exhaustion, because it can lead to larger stresses.
Thanks, Andrew. One for Stefan, I might just throw across. What if you and your business partner have the same goals but different strategies to get there?
Well, first things first, having the same goal is a positive, right? Yes. Let's just agree. You know, having the same goal is a good place to be, and not many partnerships are there. So as it relates to that question, having the same goal is perfect. And then the healthy debate, keyword healthy, debate between two difference as it relates to the crossroad, the journey, the strategy, the tactical response. Are we in vertical time, which is stuff needs to be done now? Are we in horizontal time? It gets built over time. The ability to have a healthy debate where no one is right and no one is wrong. We're just truly flushing what is the best way forward with the least resistance, with the least level of brain damage, with the least level of dumb tax, is an awesome conversation to be in. And there's never a boardroom, let alone a bedroom, that doesn't have healthy debate. How boring would life be?
Absolutely. And I mean, yeah, Andrew and I, wow, we had some massive forks in the road and a lot of stresses, I tell you. And boy, we always had the goal of having a successful business, but luckily, Andrew won that one. Let's go childcare instead of me loving sport and coaching and activities. That was all good fun, but it didn't make us much profit. So he was smart and he was right on that one. So it was certainly, there's a lot of blood, sweat and tears there. And it's never, as Andrew said, it's not even, we never had a material goal nor really a profit goal. Ours were always based on numbers of kids, number of kids in our care, number of staff, number of managers that we looked after. And, you know, we had, you know, up to 5,000 staff, and, you know, that was, you know, our pride was looking after people, and because they had to look after the precious assets of parents, which is their kids. So there was enormous stress and responsibility and pressure to get that done. And, hence why pretty much the result of our business goes pretty much close to 100% into charity these days and philanthropic needs, where we're pretty simple characters from the eastern suburbs. We played a bit of footy and sport and phys ed teachers. And, you know, really, we see the greatest joy now, you know, because you work hard in your business. Then, as you said, Stefan, you can decide what you want to do with time and money. And, you know, certainly from Andrew's and my point of view, toys and money and external things do not bring any happiness. There's no doubt in our minds. We've been through it, as many people have. But massive joy internally comes when you do help others and service others. And that's what we're going to lead to in the later sessions. We're going to be speaking to Daniel Wordsworth, the CEO of World Vision, will be a special guest. He's a leader in the world on philanthropy. So a really good point. One I just wanted to throw to Jay, because I think this is a real relevant in the COVID times here. And it was, I think it was one here from, Marita. What do you do if you think people on your team or in your family are not coping at the moment? And how do you approach the subject?
Well, that's actually a really topical one. It's really common at the moment. And I think one of the things to remember, and it sort of comes back to what was just being said about your business, the strength of each of us comes down to our ability to influence others. And it comes down from our own personal resilience. So if in your team or in your family or in your life, you come across people who are really struggling, who are really languishing, it's really important not to be overtly positive, because that can be patronising, but rather reach out in a way which you can offer support, offer strength, offer guidance, and offer influence. Sometimes it's not a good idea to directly address the situation, as it is to actually allude to it by perhaps, for example, say someone's cut off and they're starting to avoid connections. So encouraging them to do things that you know that perhaps they'd like to do, rather than saying, you know, pointing out the fact that they seem to be avoiding or cutting themselves off, is a good idea. Working from a position of strength is always a good idea as well, rather than focusing on their weaknesses. So there will be some things that they are doing that are really good. So enhancing, turning the volume up on your recognition of that is often a much better approach than actually highlighting what they're not doing very well or what they're struggling with. Because all of us seem to enjoy building rather than defending or protecting. So ultimately, we like to actually have our value raised rather than just try and hide away. But it's just that we're scared to do it. So finding someone who recognises your strengths and point it out and share that journey with you to build that strength is much better sometimes than just sitting down and saying, what's wrong?
Brilliant work. Thanks, Judd. Just in sake of time there, we're going to round up today. There's a few more questions there. We'll try and get back to those on the chat and we'll carry some over to the next session. But I think that covered off resilience in the business setting and personally really well, and a great session to kick off. Love the rewords, Stefan. The positive opportunities, looking for those opportunities, controlling progression and movement, you know, that flow and movement. And mastery, focusing on those goals, setting those goals, getting back now in these times to what we can set and go with. Love the Andrew's points there. Value adds, you know, just a massive one from our series last year. You know, I think when you're always adding value, that's when you get that progression, you get that uplift, that inspiration. It's fantastic. Andrew's points on never giving up. I mean, there's just times we all know in life, in health, in you know, in business, you feel like giving up, but I mean, it was just an absolute staple for us to never give up. And to, you know, when things are right down, there is only one way. The only way is up, as our father and the chairman of our company did say many times. And it's, you know, it's a real good one to look in a positive sense. Business is that roller coaster. You'll have plenty of ups and downs and bumps on the journey, and you've got to ride them through. And work with others, really open it up to your key people and managers to share the experience, share the way out, and strategize to get to where you want to go. People are different. Yeah, there's, as I said, we had thousands of staff and they're all different, and the way you relate to them and care for them and train them and recognize and reward them was a big part of how we built our business, which was a pretty huge people-based business. Funny about that. We've just finished our first book on building a people-based business. Little plug there. But, so it really was. That's the thing I miss the most, the people, all the staff, and seeing all the parents and the kids and the thousands of schools we had. I actually do miss that in our business. And so sometimes your business is way bigger than just the nuts and bolts and the monies and the strategies and all the marketing and all that sort of thing. But, you know, I think there was some good messages from that today. Always underpinned by values, and the Rockefeller habits certainly, you know, refer to that. Judd's stuff on resilience, it's just brilliant. And I love that it has to be tested, like resilience, it has to be tested. You know, it builds resilience, you know, it builds it over time. It takes strength, courage, adaptability, and believing in your capacity as a human. And we probably can do a lot more and get through a lot more than we can actually imagine. And I say that to a lot of the elite sports people I train with. When they're exhausted, they're trying their best, you know, times are tough, you're down in a game, et cetera. You know, you've got to hang in there, and you may find something you thought you never had. And that was really the base of our business, how we built it, was from a bit of a sport base and a real determination to go all the way. Been fantastic. Looking forward to next week. We've got Tim Donohue. He was a leading financial planner. He's been in the top 50 of that in Australia for a number of years. He's a great global expert and local expert. Where you put your shares, where you put your money, how the world's going, how it's going to look in the next few years. So I really look forward to having Tim, who was also a board member on our business as well, a really intriguing guy. We've got young entrepreneurs, Tom Phillips from the Hawthorn Footy Club and his mate Xavier Morgan. They've got the Super Boost streak. The mighty Super Boost. It's the new hydration for young kids, and better than Gatorade, and the amount of sugar and all those things in those very sticky type sweet drinks people spray all over themselves after the footy matches there. But It'd be great to hear their little story. As I said, Daniel Wordsworth's locked in from World Vision, and we're hoping to get Samantha Gash, an ultra-resilient person, a social activist, lawyer, ultra-marathoner who's run all the major marathons around the globe. And so a great lineup coming up, and our resident team will be back again next week. And a big thanks to Robin, also Nikki behind the scenes, because it takes them to produce this. And thank you again for attending, everyone. Have a great day, first day of spring.